The Four Courts, Dublin, June 1922. Former members of the IRA, in the uniform of a new Irish army, fire on their old comrades within 7 months of winning from the British an Irish Free State. Ireland was engaged in civil war. So soon after winning the Free State, how could this come about? In a treaty signed with the British government 7 months before, Ireland had won greater freedom than she'd enjoyed for centuries. This new freedom, though, had been won with three important qualifications. First, the new Irish state created by the treaty was to be called not a republic, the ideal of Irish republicans since Wolfe Tone's day, but an Irish Free State. Secondly, this new Irish Free State was to have control of only 26 counties of Ireland. 6 counties of Northern Ireland were to be partitioned from it. Thirdly, members of the new Irish Free State's Parliament, the Dáil, had to swear an oath to be faithful to the British King as head of the British Commonwealth, of which the new Free State was to be a part. These three qualifications were deeply resented by large sections of the IRA, which thus split into rival pro-treaty and anti-treaty forces. The man who'd masterminded the whole IRA campaign against the British, Michael Collins, had signed the treaty. While the negotiations were still going on, some people wondered if he were being outmaneuvered by the British Prime Minister, Lloyd George. Collins sent dispatches back to Dublin and in the evenings came back from Downing Street to the house in Hans Place where the Irish delegation was staying.
Michael Collins came back from the negotiations and described in detail how clever Lloyd George was and how what a good actor he was, how he had put his arms around him and said, come on, Michael, have a look at this map. And there's a map of the world with British Empire painted in red on it. Said, why don't you come in and help us to run this empire? After all, lots of this empire consists of Irish people. You could help us to run it. Collins gave this as an instance of Lord George's persuasive powers and his powers of acting, that he wasn't taken in by at all. But I knew it had had an effect on him.
Also, while the negotiations were still going on, the IRA had continued to drill in Ireland under the truce with the British in case of emergency. The man who'd sent Collins, Griffith, and the other delegates to London was Éamon de Valera, known as the Longfellow, nationalist Ireland's political leader. He'd stayed in Ireland, knowing that some compromise on the IRA's republican ideal was inevitable. How much compromise was the problem?
What you swear me was that there were virtually no communications between London and Dublin, except these dispatches, so you spring backwards and forwards. And I often felt it would have been much better if the delegation had gone back to Dublin every Friday night, for instance, and come back every Sunday night, that so there could have been direct contact between De Valera and the ministers in Dublin and the delegation itself.
But why couldn't Collins and Griffith and the other delegates use the telephone?
You see, it's very hard to realise the telephones in those days were not like telephones today. I think Downing Street only possessed one telephone. They were very hard to use, they were very antiquated old machines that you wound a thing like this to ring a bell, and very crackling noises. And a telephone call between Dublin and London was very difficult through a very antiquated apparatus.
The delegates had, after all, been sent by De Valera with full powers. And so, without finally consulting Dublin, the Irish delegates had signed the treaty with the British government. Signatures of the British cabinet on the left, IRA men and members of the Dáil on the right. For the British, this meant, they imagined, the end of 7 centuries' trouble with Ireland, and the King and his Privy Council came out into the garden of Buckingham Palace to congratulate themselves on that achievement. But for Ireland, it became clear at once that the treaty meant new troubles and new bitterness of a terrible sort. The main objection was to be the oath to the king. One man met a friend who rejoiced prematurely.
He was absolutely up in his hat with delight. He said, "Isn't it marvellous? It's marvellous. The treaty is signed," he said, "and there's no oath. There's no oath," he said. He said, "I couldn't have believed it. I didn't believe it could ever happen." He was back that evening again, though. Very different man, because by that time the news had come out that there was an oath.
People began to divide for and anti-treaty.
Well, I was against it all the time. Still am. I still maintain it was one of the big mistakes. What I'm against it for, they were all trusted men. And one of the last messages they got before they left for London was, "Sign nothing until you come back first." Well, they signed it.
Eamon de Valera had been in Limerick when the treaty was signed, and on returning to Dublin was to denounce it vehemently inside and outside the Dáil. But it was to be the attitude of the IRA itself that would be all important. Some confronted their old chief, Michael Collins.
And I met Collins the morning he arrived back. I met him in the Gresham Hotel. And so I said, "Well, I'm sorry, I don't agree." But I see, he immediately said, "Yes, I understand. I thought you wouldn't. But it's the best we could do."
Well, I could see that some of the clauses were framed in such a way that they could evolve into something else. They weren't hidebound. The only thing that Lloyd George insisted on was the oath. And that didn't bother any of us particularly. Because, like the slogan during the by-elections before prior to the election of 1918, the slogan was, "Put him in to get him out." And we'd take the oath to get rid of it, which eventually happened.
At the time, the oath and allegiance played a much more considerable part than the question of partition. Somehow or another, partition was never regarded as a reality. It was felt that sooner or later, somehow or another, one get rid of partition. But the big question of principle was the question of the oath of allegiance of the British Crown. And I suppose this is understandable enough because in a way, everything that had been done in the country from the famine on was always done in the name of the Crown.
And it was this question of the oath that was to dominate the debates on the treaty that took place in the Dáil, sitting then on the first floor of this building in Dublin in December 1921 and January 1922. In those debates, the loss of the 6 counties in the north, partition, was hardly mentioned. The tension was over this question of the oath and the almost mystical question involved with it. In the delegates' failure to win a sovereign Irish republic instead of an oath-bound free state, had the IRA been betrayed? Had the country been sold to the old enemy? Or had Michael Collins won in the treaty, as he insisted, a stepping stone to the republic and the freedom to achieve freedom? When Collins arrived to make these points in the debate, an old IRA comrade who was there to hear him was Joe Sweeney.
I was there when all the vital issues were discussed, when the stepping stone idea was put up, and when Griffith said if he died and was to be buried, that he wanted to be buried alongside Michael Collins. And Collins made an emotional speech afterwards. And then we had the spectacle of de Valera breaking down, weeping in the Dáil. and the whole thing breaking up. And of course, at the time, there were rumors that all those who voted for the treaty were going to be shot.
The outcome was 64 for the treaty and 57 against. A small but clear majority that reflected opinion in the country. But many Republican idealists stood by De Valera, who now resigned the political leadership to Arthur Griffith and Michael Collins. With the treaty ratified by the Dáil, the seat of government, Dublin Castle, was handed over by the British.
We saw a taxi coming in, and from a little vantage place, a spy hole, because the doors were locked on the inside so we couldn't interrupt the proceedings, I just happened to be looking through when I saw the last Lord Lieutenant of Ireland, it was Viscount Fitzalan of Derwent, moving forward from the big table, the council chamber, to greet Michael Collins, who was coming in the door, a big man, and shaking hands.
Collins left with Kevin O'Higgins, who was to become a member of the new Irish Free State government. And Free State troops took over barracks from the British. Collins himself built up pro-treaty elements of the IRA, together with new recruits, into a Free State National Army. The British Army, except for certain garrison rights in four Irish naval ports, the British Army now left 26 counties of Ireland forever. They played themselves out to the strains of Let Erin Remember the Days of Old. But in six counties in Northern Ireland, British sovereignty stayed, and a border with the Free State was now watched by the new Royal Ulster Constabulary on one side and the Free State Army on the other. The treaty had stipulated a boundary commission to adjust the border in accordance with the wishes of the inhabitants. But Northern Ireland's first Prime Minister, Sir James Craig, had not been party to the treaty and rejected this boundary commission, which eventually came to nothing. Invited to Dublin in January 1922, Craig said Irish unity might come one day, but not for 10, 20, or even 50 years. Violence by Republicans within Northern Ireland led to violent anti-nationalist sectarian rioting. By mid-June 1922, over 250 people had been killed, nearly twice as many Catholics as Protestants.
A scoreboard was suddenly written on the wall in graffiti. Catholics killed, Catholics so many. Protestants, so many. And this was being altered day by day as the shooting and the carnage went on.
The clearest recollection of all was the day that the religious warfare actually flared up in the shipyard and Roman Catholics were actually chased out of the shipyard. And their normal exit from the shipyard was up D Street, where I lived in the heart of East Belfast. And it was a very sad sight. There seemed to be a preponderance of elderly men amongst them. Some of them obviously had been hit by stones or something like that. There was blood coming from them, and it was a very sad sight to see them, although the peculiar thing about it was they were running. I remember this distinctly. They were running, but there wasn't anyone actually in chase. So I put it down that whatever had happened in the shipyard, they were so terrified they started to run and they just kept on running.
More than 20,000 Catholics were driven from their homes and sought shelter in the Free State.
officers from the north in the Free State Army asked to see Collins.
Collins came in, he was late, and he came in, and he said, gentlemen, I'm sorry that I'm late, and I haven't long to stay. But he said, I know what the situation is and what you're aiming to do now. He said, I am going over to London on Wednesday. This was sometime, well, within 4 or 5 days, it must have been. And he said, I have to see Lloyd George. And I'm going to tell Lloyd George that if he does not stop this pogrom, now these, I'll give you my word of honor, those are Collins' very words. If they do not put the bar up and stop this thing, he can have his bloody treaty.
Collins represented the state of affairs in angry terms in London without getting any satisfaction. And the reaction to this was that if the people who were murdering the Catholics in Belfast couldn't be controlled otherwise, that he would turn the IRA on them.
What did Collins mean by the IRA at this point? He meant a powerful group of IRA men who'd firmly declared themselves against the treaty and had set themselves up for the past 2 months in the forecourts here as an independent anti-treaty force on the Irish scene. Their leaders were Joe McKelvey, Rory O'Connor, Liam Mellows, and Richard Barrett. And Collins was thinking of deflecting their Republican energies away from the Free State, whose authority they challenged, to defense of the Catholics in the North. With the leaders in the forecourts was Sean McBride.
We had been negotiating with Collins throughout lots of that period for the transfer of arms, which we were getting from the Free State Army. The really British arms had been handed over to Beggarsbusch Barracks, that were transferred to the IRA for use in Donegal and in the North.
At the same time, Collins began to address vast meetings preparatory to the first general election in which the Irish people themselves could pronounce on the treaty. In a desperate attempt to defuse the growing tension and keep the gun out of politics, Collins agreed to an electoral pact with the anti-treaty De Valera. They presented the electorate with a joint panel of candidates reflecting the existing divisions in the Dáil, and they urged the electorate to ignore all other candidates. But below this paper-thin arrangement, tension ran very high. And the gun was by no means out of politics. Collins had agreed to the panel pact to enable an election to take place at all. On the eve of the actual vote, he suddenly told people to vote for whom they liked, pro-treaty candidates outside the pact if they wanted. He completed the campaign in his native county of Cork, hoping for a decisive pro-treaty victory. The election result was indeed a decisive victory for Collins and the treaty. But the peaceful consolidation of the Free State government's authority he'd hoped for was not to be. The British Field Marshal, Sir Henry Wilson, who'd been advising Northern Ireland on security and who was mistakenly held by many Irishmen, including Collins, as responsible for the pogroms there, was shot dead in London by two IRA men who, at some time, had both actually had orders from Collins to do this. But had Collins known what they were up to now?
Collins's reaction would suggest to me that this is a thing that Collins deplored, but nevertheless felt he had some responsibility for, in the sense that he had decided before the truce that it should be done. Well, he certainly deplored the shooting of Wilson, but at the same time, he made strenuous efforts to save the men who shot him.
The British wrongly thought the shooting was the work of the anti-treaty men in the Dublin forecourts and sent an ultimatum to Collins to do something about them. But Collins had already decided to act against the men in the forecourts and sent the Free State Army to deal with them.
Various suggestions were made at a staff meeting about what way to go about it best. It was suggested that they be starved from water, water supply cut off and food supplies cut off. And I'm afraid I personally objected to that. I was by way of being director of operations, amongst other problems, and I advocated shelling it.
They borrowed field guns from the British with which to do so.
We fired off a few shells, and of course, they were mostly shrapnel and only scratched the stone. Dalton said to me, fire one every quarter of an hour. They'll get fed up and come out. That went on for a time, and they showed no sign of coming, getting fed up. Part of the forecourts was brick instead of stone, and we fired there, and the crack developed in the wall, and we kept on firing at the crack till it brought it down to the bridge. Well, unfortunately, in depressing the thing, one of the fellows depressed it too far, and the key wall was in front of us at a distance of about 30 yards, and we hit the key wall.
The Irish Civil War now began in earnest. The men in the forecourt surrendered, and the anti-treaty IRA took up other positions in the centre of Dublin, with headquarters in O'Connell Street at the Hammam Hotel.
We were instructed to take over the Hammond, and we had to walk in where the people were sitting down, having their meals and different things, and start causing eruptions and ordering them out. And an awful job to do, and they had to run up and get their things and all. And we got them out. And when we got them out, we barricaded the doors.
Bitter street fighting between the pro-treaty Free State forces and the anti-treaty IRA, pro-treaty not always in uniform, now took place in the centre of Dublin. In 8 days, 60 people were killed and 300 wounded. In the Hammam Hotel in O'Connell Street, Cathal Brewer, a Republican hero of 1916, was in charge.
He was angry with the Free State Army. He said we were sold. The country was sold after all our fight. Sold with the treaty. Sold out we were. And these are our own Irish men to say they do that. And he says particularly Arthur Griffith, the father of Sinn Féin, which means ourself alone. And he should accept this allegiance to the British king and sign it. And that wasn't ourselves alone. And he mentioned all these things, Cathal Brewer. And he spoke of these things. And he spoke with bitterness, you know, in his mind.
Brewer eventually came out with guns blazing and was shot down by Free State troops. Another anti-treaty IRA man, Liam Lynch, now took command of the Republican forces in the country, and the Civil War spread west and south across Ireland. The Free State Army was much better equipped. They were already a regular army and contained many Irishmen formerly in the British Army. Those against whom they deployed their superior equipment became known as irregulars, elusive and even invisible in the countryside.
Gradually, the Free State began to gain the upper hand against an enemy with only minority support among the population.
You had families divided, old families, brother against brother. You know, you know yourself that civil war, it takes generations to wipe out the bitterness of a civil war. And 'twas bloody awful, I can tell you that.
In the middle of this bitter tragedy, Ireland heard, stunned, that Arthur Griffith, the father of Sinn Féin and joint guardian with Collins of the new Free State, had died suddenly in Dublin. Collins helped carry Griffith's coffin at the funeral. Collins stood by Griffith's grave at Glasnevin Cemetery. Within a week, he was to be dead himself. Since communication across southwest Ireland was still being seriously interfered with by the anti-treaty Republicans, Free State troops were sent round by sea to take the city of Cork, a Republican stronghold. They landed without difficulty and met little resistance, and Collins himself soon came to join them.
As we went around Cork City for a bit, the first thing that struck our eye was in all the big dead walls of Cork, here and there, places that were burned down by the Black and Tans, Collins marches through Cork, why not through Belfast? So we were taking note of all those things, but we were told by our officers before we left to be very careful because Cork City was a very dangerous place and that a Free State soldier might be bowled over there.
Collins himself had decided to make a tour of Free State positions in County Cork.
I told him he was taking an unnecessary risk. He said, surely, he said, they won't shoot me in my own county.
From Cork, Collins travelled on the 22nd of August 1922 with a well-armed convoy through Macroom and down the road southwards to inspect positions in the small town of Skibbereen, which had once suffered so terribly in the time of the Great Famine. Collins himself, given an enthusiastic welcome in Skibbereen, was with Emmett Dalton in a big Leyland touring car. Travelling back towards Cork, along the same route as they'd taken out in the morning, they came in the evening to a small valley known as Beal na Bla. There had that day been a secret gathering of anti-treaty officers in the area who knew that Collins had passed through once and were waiting for him now.
I was told that Collins passed through in the morning, and that he inquired the way to Bendon.
The convoy was led by a motorcycle scout, a Lieutenant Smith, who went ahead of the rest of them.
So we came along through this valley until we came practically to the end of it. And this Lieutenant Smith, the dispatch rider, was in front of us all the time, not going far away, but he just had come down and he had just returned back again to tell us that there was an obstruction on the road. So we ran, before we had time to pull up, we ran right into the obstruction, which consisted of a four-wheel horse dray full of porter bottles, and a lot of porter bottles broke and strewn around the road.
The ambush was already laid.
We're on the left-hand side of the road going down into Beal na Bla. We were on the left-hand side in a narrow body, and that was the ambush position. After a lot of officers came the private touring car. And after the private touring car came the the armored car. No, I fell at the top of the car, to Michael Collins with him. Why didn't I see the two of them jumping out of the car? They were all out, and up along the fence they took the necessary cover.
After a time, the firing lulled, and we only heard distant shots, distant peals of shots, like away in the direction of Cork. And General Michael Collins stood up and had a gaze around him. He was loading his rifle in the meantime. And whilst he was loading his rifle, one long shot, apparently like from a sniper, rang out and hit him in the side of the head, the right-hand side there, fell down, and he never spoke again.
I heard two shots being fired, and I then saw Michael Collins, I didn't know it was him at the time, saw this man get up and fall down again, you see. And I saw Dalton, whom I didn't recognize at the time, run towards him and catch him. When I got up near to Collins, he was holding him like that in his arm, and he was whispering in his ear. We understood it was an act of contrition.
He had been shot. He was lying there with a very gaping wound in the back of his head. So I called the armored car back, and we lifted him and took him onto the side of the armored car and moved behind the armored car, with the armored car between us and the their firing position. Got him to the position on the side of the road, and under protection of the armored car, we bandaged the wound. I bandaged the wound, and O'Connell said an act of contrition to him. I knew he was dying, if not already dead.
Coming back with the body, the convoy ran into another obstruction, and they had to change vehicles.
We had to shoulder his body then for about 3 fields out onto the main road until we got it out to the Crosley Tinder. We all had to take turns in it. All his men had to take turns in it, including General Dalton, and everyone that was there had to take turns, because a big, heavy man dying in his perfect health. I suppose Collins was a man that time, 16 or 17 stone probably. A man that stood over 6 feet anyway. We had to take turns at him, and we shouldered him, and it wasn't so easy. It wasn't an easy task, because there was blood and brain matter dripping down on top of us. So we shouldered him out onto the main road and put him onto the Crosley Tinder.
Collins's body was eventually brought back to Dublin.
It seemed like a part of the world had died as well, and something we loved and believed in had died. But this was not universal. Just a few doors away from us in Wilson Place, and I remember this very vividly. I ran into the house from the street, and the woman of the house was reading the newspaper, and on the front of the paper was Collins dead, and she said, "Isn't it glorious news?" Now, only a month or two back, that woman would have given her life for Michael Collins. But in the meantime, her allegiance was on the other side, and she really didn't. She was delighted that Collins was dead, but the rest of us grieved.
The funeral was attended by the full cabinet of the Free State, bereft now of the two men who'd done most to found it, Griffith and Collins. The new Prime Minister was William Cosgrave. Collins's brother and sister stood beside his grave. The new Prime Minister Cosgrave was determined to establish the Free States Authority and to take the most severe measures if necessary to do so.
In the earlier period of the Civil War, there was no severity being used. Many people who were arrested in the early days were just given a kick in the backside and sent home. And they turned up again in arms. They were treated less gently. And eventually, after some months of this, it was enacted that the carrying of arms would in itself be an offence carrying the death penalty.
The extreme Republican Erskine Childers, half English, who'd brought guns for the volunteers into Howth in 1914, was one of the first to be shot.
We couldn't make exception for what we regarded as the son of an English statesman over ordinary Irish youths who'd been caught in the fighting.
He was executed for what? In possession of a small automatic that he got from Mick Collins as a present. I mean, that was a great excuse to execute a great man.
If we had caught De Valera with a revolver in his possession, he would have got the same treatment as anybody else.
De Valera being now with the Republicans.
The thing took a completely new complexion when Liam Lynch issued an order to the effect that all TDs and senators who had voted for this legislation authorising the execution of people being caught under arms, the people who had voted for that should be shot at sight. And immediately following this, two TDs who were travelling in a sidecar up to the Ormond Hotel, Sean Hales of Cork and Padraig O'Malley of Galway, were fired at, and Hayes was killed and O'Malley was wounded.
The Free State Cabinet now decided to take the most drastic action. They held as prisoners the four anti-treaty commanders from the four courts, including Rory O'Connor.
My idea was that we should take 8 or 10 of the leading irregulars who had been in the four court, put them before a military committee in the morning and shoot them the morning after. But the meeting was already in progress, and I found it being proposed that four named persons, a leader of the anti-treaty forces from each of the four provinces, should be shot summarily the following morning. Well, I immediately thought that that was a better idea than my own, would strike more terror and would involve less loss of life. So I didn't put my own proposition before it. After about 3 or 4 minutes discussion, Mr. Cosgrave put the proposal to the meeting. Desmond Fitzgerald was asked first, and he said yes. I was asked second, and I said yes. And then Kevin O'Higgins was asked, and Kevin said, "Is there no other way?" I realised afterwards that perhaps Kevin was thinking of Rory O'Connor, who had been a personal friend and who had been best man at his wedding.
Rory O'Connor's cell in Mountjoy Jail was shared by Sean McBride. Porgin O'Keefe, the governor, and his aide came in at 3 o'clock in the morning and told them both to dress.
They went out and left us to dress. I got up and dressed. Rory got up and dressed. Rory had with him, he had been best man to Kevin O'Higgins' wedding, and he had with him the gold and silver coins that had been used at the wedding. And he wanted to give them to me. I should mention, yes, O'Keefe came back and said, "You can go back to bed. You're not coming."
Pather O'Donnell was in another cell that morning.
Padraig O'Keefe woke me up and then told me to go back to my bed, that my name wasn't on the list. I didn't know what he was talking about. And I said to him afterwards that there was something he must tell us, what were the last hours of Mellows and O'Connor. "I have no story to tell," he said. "I just brought them out. And there were 2 bottles of whiskey. Phil Cosgrave and I, that's brother of the Prime Minister, went to bed drunk. and I knew nothing more about them and just knew they were shot.
Most of the prisoners in Mountjoy knew nothing of the shooting of the four men until Mass that morning.
Yeah, the priest turned round on the altar and he said to us, "I know, Cecy, that you all will join me in offering up this Mass for the souls of your dead comrades who are on their way to the Maker this minute. Rory O'Connor, Liam Mellors, Dick Barrett and Joe McCallery." Then pandemonium of this, driving man jumped up, but you were locked in, you could do nothing. I seen Lamas, John Lamas, John T. O'Kelly, Dr. Ryan, they were all prisoners, and I seen them crying like children.
Altogether, 77 Republicans taken in arms were to be executed by the Irish Free State in 7 months, twice the number executed by the British since 1916. More were actually sentenced to death.
But they didn't carry out the sentence. They left you under the sentence. But if somebody on their side, on the other side, was shot while you were in prison, well, your life could go for it. So you were condemned to death, and you had the agony of never knowing whether you were going to die or not.
On the army generally, it was a great damper. Nobody wanted to get involved in that kind of thing. It's one thing to stand up and trade shots with a man. It's another thing to get him out when he's helpless and kill him. So that it had a very bad effect in that way.
In the field, many more anti-treaty Republicans were killed out of hand when they surrendered.
He gave us a cigarette. He said, "That's the last cigarette he'll ever again smoke." He said, "We're going to blow you up at a mine, a war floor mine." Anyone didn't say anything. We were moved out into the yard, then out, marched into a lorry and made lie flat down in the lorry and taken out to Belly CD. We arrived out and the language was abusive language, wasn't too good. But one fella called us Irish bastards. And he was an Irishman himself. But another fella, one of our lads, asked to be left say his prayers. He said, "No prayers." He said, "Old fellas didn't get any time for prayers." And he says, "Maybe some of you might go to heaven." He said, "You might meet old fellas there." And they tied us in, our hands behind our back, and left about a foot between the hands, like, and the next fella. And they circled, they tied us in a circle in around the mine. And they tied our legs in, and the knees as well, with a rope. And then they tore off our caps and they said, "We could be praying away now as long as we like." So the next fella to me said his prayers, and I said mine too. But I still kept watching for a day went, like. It was that saved me afterwards. But he said goodbye then, and I said goodbye, and the next fella picked it up, and he said, "Goodbye, goodbye, lads," and up it went. And I went up with it, of course.
You had so many people who were in favour of the treaty. You had all the pro-British people, all the settled business people and all this kind of thing. And of course you had the clergy who used the pulpit very much to denounce you at every opportunity that you were being, well, you're just robbers, looters and murderers and all that kind of thing, you see.
We were excommunicated. They issued a joint pastoral excommunicating anyone who was in the IRA or anyone who supported them, I think. I think they even included those who supported them.
The attitude of the church, well, they condemned us from every angle. I mean, I often went to church and walked out and been pointed out down the end of the church as a robber or murderer or something like that. My father died during the Civil War and they wouldn't allow him to enter the church because he happened to be my father.
You meet a fellow who was a volunteer and you say, I want you to go over to such and such a place with a dispatch. Well, I can't do that now because I was with the priest at confession. He told me under any circumstances not to do any work for you, so I can't do it.
In the south, especially in West Cork, which had a tradition against the British forces, they fought very determinedly. But they came up against the same trouble everywhere. The people wanted the end of hostilities, and all their haunts were known. If you wanted to find them, you always had the choice of going here, there, or some other way. And they found that eventually they weren't able to carry on, that they had no popular support.
The end really came when the anti-treaty commander, Liam Lynch, was killed after a running fight in the Knockmealdown Mountains in Tipperary.
Then we dumped arms when the ceasefire order came. And it was pretty bloody awful for a while because we were hunted like rabbits. I remember we were surrounded in a field one day. We went out to lie in the sun to get a bit of sleep or something. And some kids going to school met the Free State column and they told them there were men lying up in the field and they surrounded us and fired indiscriminately. They didn't even ask us to put up our hands, but we got through. I got through anyway. And they chased for about 3 miles and firing all the time. Shot some cattle and all the rest of it. But that was the setup. I mean, it was bad. We were like rabbits. In the end, then, after a year or so, I know I got out. I went to Canada. Went from there to the States. I had to go. Just, I'd be just bloody well shot us all.
Well, it was tough. A lot tougher than it was on the run in the black and tan time. But I mean to say, you must have the people with you in guerrilla warfare. Well, we hadn't.